original. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is a story of one man's journey through a dark moment in Hollywood history. It is based on the letters and diaries of Carl Foreman and the recollections of those who lived through that time.
Hollywood's veneer of glamour shines so brightly that at times it seems that's what it's all about. But the true muscle and sinew of Hollywood is hard work. Days that grind on for 18 hours or more. Back-breaking labor, sometimes in heat, sometimes in cold, and always, it seems, in dust. The rewards are income, sometimes a great deal, and for very, very few, fame. But the weight of these rewards depend ultimately upon on-the-screen credit. That is the heart and soul of Hollywood. Sanctity of on-screen credit is holy and was the major driving force in the creation of both the writers' and directors' unions. It is the only lasting testimony to a person's work. Nothing is more treasured in the Hollywood creative community than on-screen credit. Public evidence of that person's work. The issue would haunt a piece of film history. It began on July 24, 1952, when a motion picture opened that would change American filmmaking, particularly the Western. The next day in the New York Times, Bosley Crowther, the greatest film critic of his time, wrote,
"Every 5 years or so, somebody, some new talent and taste, with a full appreciation of legend and a strong trace of poetry in their soul, scoops up a handful of cliches from the vast lore of Western films and turns it into a thrilling and inspiring work of art in this genre. Such a rare and exciting achievement is Stanley Kramer's production of High Noon, which was placed on exhibition at the Mayfair yesterday. Which one of the several individuals is most fully responsible for this job is a difficult matter to determine, but nothing about which to quarrel. It could be Mr. Kramer who got the picture made. It could be scriptwriter Carl Foreman who prepared the story for the screen. Certainly, director Fred Zinnemann had a great deal to do with it. And possibly Gary Cooper as the star had a hand in the job."
Take note that the very first review of High Noon raises the question of creative inspiration, which isn't surprising. High Noon would go on to win 4 Academy Awards from 7 nominations. And yet High Noon has no on-screen producer credit. None, not one, not any. That's more than a fatherless child. It's as if it has no maker.
Hollywood began as a producer's medium. It began as a place where films were producer-driven.
In those days, editors and the editing was in the hands of the producer. Today, a director edits his own picture. That's a big difference. The final word on everything was in the producer's hands.
The producers in the so-called golden age of Hollywood carried a lot of weight. They were the boss, they ran the show, and they had mostly final say. It's very few directors could override the producer.
In the beginning, there was no doubt who was the producer of High Noon. And how did his credit disappear? Well, the answer to that question begins by remembering another question that in 1950 bedeviled American life in general, and Hollywood in particular.
Are you a member of the Communist Party? Or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
It's unfortunate and tragic that I have to teach this committee the basic principles of Americanism.
That's not the question. That's not the question. Stand away from the stand.
I have written for Americanism for many years, and I shall
stand away from the stand.
Fight for the Bill of Rights, which you are trying to destroy.
This man away from the stand.
1948 was a year in which America's preoccupation with the threat of domestic communism became very real. The war was over. Our former ally had occupied Eastern Europe. The Iron Curtain had descended across Europe. In 1949, China fell to the communist movement. The Soviet Union closed off Berlin to normal land traffic. And in West Berlin, which was occupied by the American, British, and French forces, these people faced the risk of starving to death during the winter. So the Berlin airlift was organized by the Western Allies. And this was, to Americans, another example of the fact that you cannot trust the Soviet Union. In 1950, North Korea invaded South Korea and brought America back into a war. Joseph McCarthy made his famous speech about there being 205 communists, more or less, somewhere located in the federal government. These were real times, and they just did not just frighten conservatives in the country, they frightened liberals as well. So this was a time in which America came face to face with this apparent large domestic threat. And that's the background against which the events have to be understood.
But this is more than the story of the Blacklist. It speaks of art and ugliness and friendship and betrayal, of solidarity and treachery. This is a story of how one man's producing credit was taken from him. How could that creative credit be taken in an act of apparent betrayal by the colleagues this man loved most? Well, that's one of the dirty little secrets of the Blacklist. That it was not merely an enterprise of cold-eyed studio heads and evil politicians, though they certainly existed. The Blacklist worked for the same reason the Vichy France worked. It was something that we all too often happily did to one another.
And Carl went through so much. That treatment that made me break the Blacklist with my film, Spartacus.
Nine Roman armies have been destroyed by Spartacus.
Spartacus. Because at that time, a blacklisted writer, Dalton Trumbull, was working under the name of Sam Shepard. He was not allowed to come to the studio, but all my colleagues knew it was Dalton Trumbull. To me, this is all related to what Carl Foreman was suffering. Then we said, what name are we going to use on the script, Sam Shepard? And Stanley Kubrick said, use my name. Stanley, wouldn't you feel funny to take a credit of another person's work? And that upset me. And that night when I went home, I thought about it. And the next morning, I made a decision. I wrote a note to Dalton Trumbull, not Sam Shepard. I invited him to come to the studio, and I instructed the studio. It was my production, Brandon. I said, we will use Dalton Trumbull's name on the screen.
And that simply, the Blacklist was broken after some 8 years of anguish. But there was no one with that courage in 1951. And so High Noon, the film that should have vouchsafed Carl Foreman's place in film history, would begin life as a foundling.
Do not forsake me, oh my darling.
Carl Foreman's writing contract was in his own name, so the writing credit was protected by the Screenwriters Guild and couldn't be touched. But he also produced the film. It was an orphan to his partner, Stanley Kramer. But once High Noon was seen for the brilliant work it really was, a fundamental change took place in the film's creative credit.
I was the editor of High Noon. I won an Academy Award for my work on it. As an editor, I had to make up the titles, you know. And I remember distinctly making up a set of titles when he was the producer. Nobody ever told me directly to take Carl off that I can remember, to take his credit off. I don't remember that.
A terror-stricken town left him to face four killers, single-handed, at High Noon. With every swing of the pendulum, with every second, a man's life ticked away. Never have so few moments held such excitement.
It's a strange thing that happens to people. Kramer, he had no faith in High Noon. He even threatened to shelve it and take his name off of it. But later on, because it became a big hit, he agreed to attach his name to it, naturally. In fact, until I talked to you today, I wasn't sure that Carl wasn't still on as the producer.
A missing credit is an open door, because it leaves in doubt the source of the creative spark. A case in point are the clocks of High Noon. Over the years, almost anyone connected to the making of the film has claimed to have been the inspiration for the constant pressure of images of clock and pendulum. The evidence that this device was central to Carl Foreman's vision is overwhelming. To begin with, as we shall see, everyone acknowledges his initial impetus was a real-time movie. Moreover, we have from the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, Fred Zinnemann's shooting script, and from the Foreman estate, Carl Foreman's original script, where the references are on all. In objective terms, High Noon would reformulate the Western. Westerns had been born in the earliest days of the cinema. People were riding across the range, title cards that said, "Meanwhile, back at the ranch." Buckskins, studded shirts, singing cowboys.
My parents warned me to leave a while.
Chancellor, where's Sparrow Nell? She don't seem to be around here none.
Oh, Nell? She's gone to her mine in them thar mountains. She's made a rich strike in them thar hills.
From time to time, attempts to use the genre to dig deeper would surface and leave their mark. Films like Red River, Stagecoach. But more than any other film, it was High Noon that changed the Western, raised it to a new level, to a morality tale, a passion play that revealed all of the human condition.
You know, it stands alone. At this particular moment in time, it was a really wonderful Western. I think that unity of time that it had gave it a kind of elegance, creatively speaking, that not many films had. I think that you look at High Noon now and you say, what a wonderful moment that was when all those talents came together. You can't imagine a foot wrong, a scene wrong, a frame out of place. It's one of the great classics of American filmmaking, not just as a Western, but as a filmmaking example, period.
The missing credit is both the legacy of the Blacklist and also a not too uncommon tale of how events tend to unfold in Hollywood. In personal terms, the film came to parallel events afflicting Carl Foreman's life at the time. A tale of betrayal and destruction at the hands of people Carl Foreman believed he could trust.
You want me to stick? You put the word in for me like I said.
Sure, I want you to stick, but I'm not buying it. It's got to be up to you.
But in the beginning, long before that awful series of events would befall him, Carl Foreman was just another young American kid, dreaming of making a life for himself in the dark days of the Depression. In his case, he was sitting in the south side of Chicago, looking out across a great continent and dreaming that one day, maybe, he could find a career in Hollywood. Of course, that was a dream of millions of kids his age. But one thing Carl Foreman had going for him, right from the very, very beginning, is that, and all you have to do is look at his high school yearbook to know what we're talking about, he was a quintessential overachiever.
We went to Roosevelt High School in Chicago, and we met over a corned beef sandwich at lunchtime. There was a delicatessen about a block from the school, and a lot of kids used to go there. My sister introduced us, because she knew Carl, and she said the next thing she saw, we were gone. And he invited me to a party, etc., and so it started. We set a date to get married in October of 1938. So he came back to Los Angeles, and I met him there. Charlie Marion entered the picture, and Charlie used to sit around bars, and he would listen to all the conversations of the film people. So he said to Carl one day, they need a script for The Dead End Kids and Bela Lugosi.
What's the matter with you? That's just an echo.
It's an echo.
See that? What I tell you. There's nothing to be scared of.
That's what you see.
But boys, here we go again.
So Charlie said, can you do a story? And Carl said, oh, sure. And he sat down and wrote this story in about 3 days. Wrote a whole screenplay, and Sam Katzman was delighted with him. Charlie Ruggles, he needed some writers, some comedy writers. So they got the agent to take them to Charlie Ruggles, and Charlie liked them, and they got the job. They worked for Charlie Ruggles for a couple of years. He was very nice. And then the show went off the air. So Charlie heard about Eddie Cantor needed a couple of writers. So they got that job.
Quiet his own picture, well.
Well, that must be a real dramatic highlight, Jack.
Oh, it is, it is. Oh, well, enough about me and everything. How's Ida? Did she see my picture?
I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
Of the amusement industry's total manpower, a high percentage is now serving in the armed forces. Every branch of show business has contributed its white-collar men, technicians, and skilled artisans in answer to the call to arms. Famous actors, whose peacetime salaries reached astronomic figures, serve today on an equal footing with the members of their former public.
He went to an induction center, and they let him come home for the weekend. And I never saw a sadder sack in my whole life. Anyhow, Sunday afternoon, he had to go back, and he said he didn't know what was going to happen after that. So he said he'd call me as soon as he could. Monday morning at 7 o'clock, the phone rang, and it was Carl, and I said, where are you? He said, well, I'm still here in Long Beach, but we're being shipped out. I said, where are you going? He said, I don't know. He said, but I'll call you as soon as I get there. Well, I was kind of chewing my nails by then, but because I imagined him overseas already in the thick of the fighting. But at 11 o'clock, the phone rang again, and it was Carl. And I said, where are you? He said, at Sunset and Western. I said, what are you doing there? He said, there's a film unit here, the Capra unit, and they assigned me to it. And I'll be home for lunch, he said, because they don't have any facilities here.
To produce inspirational films for servicemen and public alike, the Army's Special Services Division has mobilized many of the industry's best editors and technicians.
So there he was in the Capra unit, first in Hollywood, then moving with it when it went to New York to the Astoria Studios, a great fabled building where movies actually began. He found himself one of a group of young, dynamic, creative people, working hard at pushing back the edge of film. It was there that he met Stanley Kramer, and there was Herbie Baker and John Weaver, who would be his dear friends until he died.
We had both arrived there at about the same time and became friends. And later, I was moved to the New York branch, and but Carl joined me there.
It was in the Capra unit that Carl's focus as a filmmaker sharpened, as he and others began to realize what limits there were and what limits there need not be. How to talk in film. Subjects they could embrace.
The most popular film that the Capra unit made was called The Negro Soldier. That film helped enormously because it was the first glimpse that black Americans had of their children and grandchildren in the service came through that particular film.
In a short while, these young officers will be full-fledged combat flyers, taking their place at the controls of our fighter planes. Today, high above their native land, they fly. Tomorrow, what a surprise the Nazis will get when black, brown, yellow, and white men, all Americans, land on the airfields of Berlin and Tokyo.
Toward the end of the war, we collaborated on a screenplay, as a matter of fact, at Astoria, and sold it just shortly before we got out of the Army. It was never made. It was assigned to the writer who named Carl. That's the irony.
Kiss me once, then kiss me twice, then kiss me once again. It's been a long, long time. Haven't felt like this, my dear, since can't remember when. It's been a long, long time.
Now, the first great interruption in his life behind him, Carl could return to Hollywood and take a second try at the great Colossus.
Kramer and I had met in the Army, and we became fast friends almost immediately, and we found ourselves in great sympathy on a great many things.
He said to Carl that he wanted to start his own company after the war, and his idea was that the script was everything. Everything was the screenplay. Well, naturally, when Carl heard that, he was delighted.
That was Screenplays Incorporated. I remember they wanted to buy fancy stationery. And I was very young to say what I did. I was saying, you can't afford it. I don't know what they, because they were having trouble paying for typewriters, renting typewriters. That was Screenplays Incorporated.
We thought that being young and and since we saw things in satirical terms, that we would begin our career as independent filmmakers with a satire.
And they were working on a film called So This Is New York. And they were looking for a director. And Herbie Baker, being a good friend of mine, recommended me for the job.
Thank you.
It was a little sleeper, but it really didn't go any place much. We heard about these GI houses that were going up in the valley. We had to put down a $10,000 deposit, which was to be returned to us when the house was finished. So we did, and a whole group of writers were in the same block.
So life on two fronts, home and work, proceeded harmoniously. Films were made, and a life based on personal relationships and on family was built.
We played cards and blackjack at my house or his house, and we really had a great relationship, one of the most pleasurable and sincere that we've ever had as a family.
Listen to the nigger lover.
I thought you'd get around to that.
Every time I see your friend's face.
Listen, please.
You listen to me, Shoeshine.
Herbie Baker and Carl and myself, the three of us, and our wives, we had a very, very nice group. We played poker. It usually ended with Herbie Baker getting in a tantrum and throwing things or making a fool of himself, but the next day, flowers would arrive of contrition, and he certainly kept the florist in good business there.
Stanley had this little house at the beach. I don't think he lived, I don't know, he rented it, I guess. It was a very little place. And every once in a while he'd have a barbecue. And we'd all go down and go to, out to his house at the beach. I guess, I don't know whether it was Santa Monica or Malibu, but it was, you know, it was along the highway somewhere. And that everybody was so friendly. And that Herbie was there, and I think Dick Fleischer probably, and I know Carl and Estelle.
By now, Stanley was married. I had introduced him to his wife. So they joined too. We were now eight people. And we used to have a very good time. We'd go out to dinner every Saturday night and then go bowling.
No, Carl Foreman, he wrote Champion. Champion made me a star.
Actors, particularly good actors, stars, real stars in every sense of the word, have tremendous weight on the screen. And it's surprising how consciously or unconsciously, as the case may be, they can sometimes dominate and change, what's been written, what's been worked at, and so forth and so on. Now, in this film, you see Kirk Douglas was playing a heel. He wasn't a heel in the beginning. Society made him that, and later on he became a champion heel. And when I remember the film came out, and my mother and father and my grandmother went to see it, you see, at the premiere, my grandmother, who was then 78 or so, and naturally she liked the film very much because I had written it, everything, and she said, "It was a wonderful film." She said, "But what I don't understand is why you made that nice boy die at the end." She meant this champion heel. The point was that Kirk, you see, who was awfully good in the part, really, he had made her love him, heel or no heel.
I was driving back from Palm Springs alone, and I was sort of sad, and I saw a big line of people around the block. And I thought, where are they going? So I drove the car parallel to the line, and I saw them all entering a theater that said Kirk Douglas in Champion. So I said, see, I'm a star.
We, Carl and I, were the very, very best and closest of friends. Our families were very close together. Carl and Estelle were at our house frequently. We were at their house. And we used to bowl every Saturday night. We played cards at certain nights of the week. We saw each other several times a week.
With Dick Fleischer, we all went bowling every week. It was ridiculous. When I think about it, La Cienega, we all went to the bowling alley. Every week, I think we had to go every... And Carl used to bring his sister and his sister. Isn't that terrible? Nobody liked his sister.
Brando, as a man who fought twice.
Oh, apologize.
Right. Who gave him the guts to face the enemy.
Embarrass me to say it. I love you.
Webb, as a man who had the pride and courage to wear his battle scars as a badge of honor.
I was a captain, Lieutenant, and I'm ordering you to cool off.
This is the exciting story of the rough and tough men who fought their way through the beachheads and battlefields of World War II.
So by the time 1950 rolled around, Carl Foreman was at the top of his game, highly successful. Two Oscar nominations under his belt, Marlon Brando's first film.
We bought this lovely house in Brentwood that had belonged to Orson Welles and Rita Hayworth. They did a terrible job on it, but I redid it and it was lovely.
There seemed to be no stopping him. He was the darling of everyone. Of course, he would learn in a few months that sometimes being very successful and being everyone's darling can also make you someone's enemy. You never know what lies in wait for you in the bushes when you come to the Darwinistic anarchy of Hollywood. But for this moment, that wasn't on his mind. All that he thought about was how he would use this new life and this new success to make greater films, to move forward. And that was the genesis of High Noon. By the time he was done, it would culminate in what should have been the greatest night in his life. You can just imagine Carl Foreman sitting there in his black tie at the Pantages Theater, watching the realization of everything he'd ever wanted and dreamed of, just smiling to himself at the great victory.
In the absence of the winner, John Wayne will accept the award for Gary Cooper.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm glad to see that they're giving this to a man who is not only most deserving, but has conducted himself throughout his years in our business in a manner that we can all be proud of him. Now that I am through being such a good sport, spouted all this good sportsmanship, I'm going to go back and find my business manager, an agent, producer, and three-name writer, and find out why I didn't get High Noon instead of Cooper. Of course, I can't fire any of these very expensive fellas, but I can at least run my 1930 Chevrolet into one of their big black new Cadillacs.
Unfortunately, Carl wasn't there. Not in Hollywood, not even in the United States. He was in exile in London, hiding from the State Department, which was hoping to seize his passport. The great rupture in his life had occurred. The shadow and storm that took him at the height of his creative power. It was the blacklist. It's easy to see in High Noon the events that were befalling Carl Foreman on a daily basis. The story reflected upon all that was happening to him. The film raises questions of honor, respect and decency, and self-sacrifice and dishonor. But he can tell you this in his own words. because when High Noon opened, it was to some of the most astonishing reviews. The first, as we know, was from Bosley Crowther, the legendary film critic. Carl read the review. It was probably 2 or 3 days old by the time the newspaper arrived in London. He went up to his room and he wrote a letter to Bosley Crowther to try and express what he felt sitting thousands of miles away as his film towered over Times Square. That letter, augmented by transcripts of later recorded interviews, offers a dazzling insight into the making of High Noon, and Hollywood, and The Blacklist.
August 7, 1952. Dear Bosley, I have at hand all the reviews and comments concerning the New York opening of High Noon, and to say that I am tremendously pleased and proud and touched and grateful is something of an understatement. Being as I am so far from home, you will understand my feelings, I'm sure. And please, don't think me insincere, but I'm particularly bucked up by your praise of the picture, as I have great respect for your critical judgment, as well as your approach to our unhappy little art. And it occurred to me, therefore, that you might be interested in the background of this film. The picture was born about 4, perhaps 5 years ago, while we were shooting So This Is New York. Actually, it came into being simply as a technical idea of the tour de force type, the telling of a motion picture story and the exact time required for the events of the story itself. Somehow, in my search for a theme, it came to me that perhaps I could write something about aggression in a Western background. The idea caught hold of me, and in about a week I'd dashed off a 4-page outline, which, so far as plot is concerned, remains the basic plot of the completed film. I remember the first person I told the idea to was Dick Fleischer, as we drove home one night together at the end of the day's shooting. He was tremendously enthusiastic.
He said, why don't we develop a story while we're driving and use this time creatively? And he said, I have a story in mind which I would like to tell you and see how you feel about it. So he did. He told me the story about the sheriff in a western town and has an hour to prepare himself for a meeting with his bitter enemies who he knows are coming to the small town to try to kill him. And it sounded like a very interesting idea, particularly if the picture were to be written and shot in real time.
As you know, writers are lonely and insecure, and I needed that enthusiasm. A few days later, I told it to Stanley, who was also very enthusiastic. We decided that we would make it after Champion, and that, if possible, we would borrow Fleischer from RKO to direct it, in view of his feeling for it. But, as you know, after Champion, we did Home of the Brave and then The Men, and in my love for both the latter projects, I didn't mind postponing High Noon. Meanwhile, I was thinking about it, and the story was taking shape and growing in my mind and in the notes I was making. And then a strange thing happened. I'd been telling the story to Rudy Sternad, and Sternad said that he had read something like it not too long before. Well, disturbed, I instituted a search of Saturday Evening Post and Collier's. He wasn't sure which, and to my chagrin, ultimately found in Collier's a very good story by John Cunningham titled The Tin Star. It was a good story, and although a very short one and not the same as High Noon, well, nevertheless, there was a great similarity in the basic situation. Actually, Cunningham's central character was much closer to the old lawman, Lon Chaney, than to mine, but his ordeal was about the same. I was certain, sure, I'd had an original idea, but on the other hand, could I be really sure I hadn't read the Cunningham story and unconsciously plagiarized it? I felt there was no other way out but to purchase the Cunningham story if we were going to make the picture. But when I took the matter up with Stanley, I was surprised and disappointed to discover that he had cooled on the project. One reason was that Hitchcock's picture Rope had since come out, using the time-for-time technique, and it had performed in a very disappointing manner. There were other reasons, of course, and among them was the fact that Stanley had developed a desire to make Cyrano. We had now reached a point in our development where more and more often decisions were being made unilaterally by Stanley, or pushed through by the force of his personality.
Well, Stanley got bigger, you know, in his own head, and he wanted to be the important one, and he got George and Carl to agree that it would be the Stanley Kramer Company. He could be very persuasive when he wanted to be.
So, in the end, we made Cyrano instead. I still wanted to make High Noon, and if the company wasn't willing to risk the money, I was. I bought the film rights from Cunningham myself, after informing Stanley and George of my intention. But after Cyrano, we held off production for several months because of United Artists' shaky condition. Meanwhile, negotiations were going on with Mr. Sam Katz and with Columbia. I had strong reservations against both these developments, but I was outvoted by Stanley and George. Finally, both deals were made.
The move from UA to Columbia must have been wonderful for Stanley and Carl, and their partner Glass, because they knew where the money was coming from, they knew what the distribution was going to be, so from that point of view, it was a very positive move. The negative side, obviously, is that you were involved with a company that had their thoughts as to how certain things were to be done, what would sell, what would not sell. So it was a good relationship, but it was not a relationship without its essential conflicts and contrasts.
Obviously, great changes would now come into being, and only time would tell if they were to be beneficial to the people involved and their work. On a personal level, it became apparent at once that I would not now be able to direct our next picture, as had been the plan. I would now have to become a full producer as well as an executive of a large company. And our great need now was product. We had to make 7 pictures in our first year, 6 for Columbia and 1 for UA, still owed by the contract. The last remaining UA picture, well, Stanley wasn't too concerned about it. I would produce it as well as 2 more on the Columbia slate, and the choice of subject was left to me. At this time, Fred Zinnemann returned from making Teresa and rejoined the group for 2 pictures. We took it for granted that we would work together. I told him the story of High Noon, and well, that he had to do. By now, I had lived with High Noon for so long that I finally felt equipped to direct it myself, but I sighed inwardly and said okay. Naturally, I've never regretted it. Well, Stanley didn't particularly care which picture I made for UA, so I turned the Cunningham story over to the company and got my money back. It was finally getting made. By this time, of course, my thinking about its basic stuff had undergone some changes. Hollywood had changed, too, since the time I'd written that 4-page outline. As you and a few others have perceived, I began to draw inspiration from the contemporary scene. And if some of the characters have life, it is because they are, of course, drawn from living models. The fact was that from the time of the congressional investigations, from the time that it became obvious in Hollywood that this industry would in fact begin a blacklist, that the rules were being broken, certainly by 1950 and very early 1951, when the committee had made an earlier appearance, and a very dramatic one, who had forced Larry Parks and Sterling Hayden to become informers, now was when the community began to fall away. Now was when the terror really began here, and the people talked about this phenomenon all the time, that I myself felt it would be marvelous, but unlikely if I escaped being named somewhere along the line. Because people were in fact falling away, and sooner or later someone would have to say that they remembered me being in the party. At this point, the ideas in the story took on a different image, and it was then that I quite consciously began to write it as a parable of what was happening in Hollywood at the time. And in many instances, it was prophetic, and in others, I suppose, a distillation of what I saw and felt happening. I really began serious work on the screenplay, as opposed to the outline, in early 1951, at the time of the Parks and Hayden hearings, so that I quite consciously knew what I was doing at that point, although I saw no point in discussing it, even with Fred, because I felt that it would be, in a way, dangerous knowledge for him. It would make him a kind of conspirator, where this was my thing. Anyway, Freddie and I went to work happily, but it soon became obvious that it wasn't going to be an easy picture to make. Almost from the start, it was apparent that High Noon was going to be an orphan, a ransom paid to UA, completely overshadowed by the really important Columbia product. In short, a B picture on the overall slate. As its producer, I found myself short of just about everything. Money, interest, manpower, facilities. Fred and I made our headquarters at the dirty but comfortable Motion Picture Center, and I would go to my shiny new Columbia offices on Gower Street 2 or 3 times a week for conferences with the writers on my 2 other projects, The Happy Time and Member of the Wedding.
The House Un-American Activities Committee begins its film hearings in Washington. The newsreel cameras and an army of newspapermen are on hand for the biggest show in the Capitol since the Hughes investigation.
I believe that 95% of the people in California are decent, honest American citizens. The Communist Party is a minority.
I would move to the state of Texas if it ever came here, because I think the Texans would kill them on sight.
The sad thing about this history that began with HUAC in 1951 is that a division was created in Hollywood, a very ugly divide, that exists to this very day. And it exists because on both sides, no one really looks at what was really happening. No one tries to understand what was going on.
Are you a member of the Communist Party, or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
Are you a member of the Communist Party?
Are you now, or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
I have not refused to answer the question. I told you before I will answer this question
now,
fully.
Lieberman,
your purpose is to use this to disrupt the motion picture industry.
Now,
to invade
Lieberman.
The right not only of me, but of the producers, to their thoughts, to their opinions.
It was the intent of HUAC to punish all kinds of communists, not just ex-communists or not just present communists, but both kinds. And they don't care whether they punish friendly witnesses or unfriendly witnesses. They both get punished. Then we began to discover that that was their only purpose. And in fact, I discovered it with the very first hearing, which was Larry Parks. And I always felt that they chose Larry because they were still kind of in show business. And, you know, this was their opening was starring Larry Parks, who had won an Academy Award. It's a realistic example of the old joke about the anti-communist who was protesting a communist event at which there are also communists. And a cop starts beating him over the head, and the fellow looks up and says, "Hey, don't do that. I'm an anti-communist." And the cop says, "I don't give a damn what kind of a communist you are." And went on beating.
Well, of course, I've been looking for communism for a long time. I've been so strongly opposed to it for so many years. I think in the past 4 or 5 years specifically, I've seen more indications which seem to me to be signs of communist activity in preparation of scripts, specifically in the writing of those scripts. I have seen things from time to time which appeared to me to be slightly on the pink side, shall we say.
There is evidence that one of the best ways to be subpoenaed was to become a notable writer or director or actor in Hollywood. Carl Foreman was that. And when the committee became aware that Carl Foreman was being talked about, thought about, looked up to, he was subpoenaed.
I was in the middle of the screenplay when I was subpoenaed. It came as somewhat of a shock, although I suppose I must have been expecting it all along. I joined the Communist Party in 1942, left it when I went into the Army, rejoined it for a while afterwards, then dropped out. I don't think it's necessary for me to go into my motives for either entering or leaving it. Anyway, I remember that day well. I called my wife and went home early. We talked about it. A little girl ran into the room, surprised and happy to see me home before dark. I looked at my wife and said, "Who do you suppose the son of a bitch was who did this to us?" And in that moment, if there had ever been a shadow of a chance that I would buy my career for our security at the price of someone else's, it was gone forever. No hero me, and no saint, believe me, but way too much to pay.
Why are you stopping?
It's no good. I've got to go back, Amy.
Why?
They're making me run. I've never run from anybody before.
Next day, I told my partners about the subpoena and how I felt about it. Stanley was fine. We had overcome some pretty horrible things in the past, and we could lick this too. After all, the hearings were 2 months off. If the worst came to the worst, I would just stay away from the offices for a while. I would remain on salary, and I would work at home. Keep very quiet. It couldn't last more than a year. That was the worst that could happen, and he appreciated my point of view. Being a name-namer was an impossible role for me. So, I was to go back to work, and somehow we'd figure out something.
I'm just as glad that I wasn't around in those days, because it was a time of terrible moral pressure. Moral pressure, which ultimately at base was probably economic, too. should you give up your livelihood everywhere for all your life on a point of principle, of refusing to name names that had already been named, for example. That was one of the cruelest tests of all, it seemed to me.
I was notified when to appear, and I did appear, but I had decided that they had already had these names from the very start, that the one thing, that I was doing something I shouldn't be doing, just as I shouldn't, no one should be getting up there saying I refuse to answer on the grounds that it might tend to incriminate me. I shouldn't be getting up there saying, yes, my fellow members were so-and-so and so-and-so and so-and-so. But I knew one thing for sure, it was not informing, because, you know, informing consists of giving information to authorities that they don't have and that they want very badly and they're willing to deal for. And if you are, if authorities demand information from you that they already have and don't need, but if you don't give it, they will put you in jail for a year. That's something, but it isn't informing. I'm not sure what it is. But I had decided that HUAC wasn't on a high enough moral level for me to give them a year of my life for something that was meaningless.
It was obscure members of the House of Representatives looking for headlines that I think encouraged them to tackle Hollywood, because if you could get Gary Cooper to come and speak as a friendly witness about objecting to communism in Hollywood, and if you could get the well-known people to attack, then you would get headlines and you, a congressman, would suddenly be famous.
The newsreel cameras and an army of newspapermen are on hand.
Can you tell us some of the statements or that you may have heard at these gatherings that you believe are communistic?
I've heard people mention that, well, perhaps this would be a more efficient government without a Congress.
By 1951, when High Noon is being filmed, the opposition in Hollywood to the Blacklist has collapsed.
Hollywood is a community isolated from the rest of the country. In 1948, the studios were forced to sign the consent decree. The Justice Department had gone after them for their ownership of theaters and had basically dealt a body blow to the business. The heads of the studios were primarily Jewish. It was Louis B. Mayer, Harry Cohn. I think there was a concern on their part about anti-Semitism out of Washington. Certainly not unknown. They were anxious to show themselves to be good citizens and cooperate with the government. And that certainly helped lead to the Blacklist.
My brothers and I will be happy to subscribe generously to a pest removal fund. We are willing to establish such a fund to ship to Russia the people who don't like our American system of government and prefer the communistic system to ours.
I think what was true, maybe on both sides of the equation, that there were many people of patriotic fervor and good judgment and honest motives who were identified with left-wing causes, perhaps with the party, but perhaps even just with those pinko organizations, so-called. And on the other side, there's always been room in this world for honest conservatives.
Fundamentally, I would say in opposing those people that the best thing to do is to make democracy work. In the Screen Actors Guild, we make it work by ensuring every one of a vote and by keeping our members informed. And Jefferson put it a lot better than I can, but if all the American people know all the facts, they'll never make a mistake. Now, whether the party should be outlawed or not, I agree with the gentleman who preceded me that that's a matter for the government to decide. I will be frank with you that as a citizen, I would hesitate, or I would not like to see any political party outlawed on the basis of its political ideology, because we've spent 170 years in this country on the basis that democracy is strong enough to stand up and fight for itself against the inroads of any ideology, no matter how much we may disagree with it.
The production department, now headquartered at Columbia and disdainful of the Little Western, were slovenly and careless. I was constantly fighting for more money. The original budget was unrealistic, as was the schedule. Freddie's morale kept sinking. He couldn't understand what had happened to our operation, and I had to keep pretending that everything would turn out all right. Meanwhile, I finished the screenplay, and Fred and I now began to spend nights as well as days together, going over the script line by line, action by action, shot by shot, scheming to make a good picture on little money and a too short budget. And in the meantime, the subpoena situation had drifted along and had deteriorated. Each time I saw Stanley and George and Mr. Katz, the atmosphere became increasingly pessimistic. Then, to make matters worse, George was subpoenaed. We were all shocked, including me. Frankly, I'd never thought he'd cared that much about people to get involved politically. Anyway, for 3 days, he made gallant speeches about honor and guts, and then allowed himself to be led to the offices of the Hollywood attorney who acts as the go-between for the committee, and became what is called a cooperative witness. His self-betrayal had to lead him eventually to an analyst's couch, where he is today, if not something worse. Naturally, however, George's surrender made my position more difficult. My partners began to wonder why I couldn't be reasonable too, and they began to point out what very likely lay ahead for me as an individual, and for them as a group. Stanley's attitude had changed, and he went on the attack and said that he felt that it was a matter of loyalty, and he felt that I was being loyal to a bunch of communists and disloyal to him and our other partners.
At this point in the Writers Guild, the liberal forces were against loyalty oaths and were siding with the communists on that issue. Carl Foreman, for example, was quite vocal and is quite on record as having been against loyalty oaths. And in fact, when he said to some of those at the Guild who were leading the troops in favor of loyalty oaths, in favor of giving in to the times, shall we say, he was threatened. And he was told that it would come back to haunt him.
I got a call from to go up to an office one of Harry Cohn's associates. And I came in to see this guy, and he said, "I understand that you fought the non-communist oath for the Directors Guild." I said, "Well, wait a minute. I didn't fight the oath. I voted against it." He said, "What you've got to do is sign write us a letter saying that you are not a communist." I said, "But I've already signed the non-communist oath for the Guild. Once that was signed, once that was passed, we all had to sign the non-communist oath." They said, "Well, you'll have to do it again." And I said, "Well, what if I don't?" He said, "Well, do you want to direct the happy time?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Write the letter." So I went to Stanley Kramer and asked him what I should do, and he said, "Write the damn thing and forget about it. You're not the first one it's happened to."
A pamphlet called Red Channels came out, which was about the broadcast industry, just channels, not movies, radio and TV. And it listed about 100 some names of people in broadcast whose politics were not well thought of by this private right-wing outfit that published the pamphlet, and I was included. I was delighted to be starting the happy time. Sometime into production, when they were preparing a scene I was not in, I was asked if I would go to see a Mr. George Glass, a man I didn't know, but he told me about threats coming. The people who thought they were being patriots to track down Reds. They were going to see that everyone in Red Channels never worked again and threatened to harm the picture if I remained in the cast. And what he suggested was that I take out full-page ads in the two trade papers, the Hollywood Reporter and the Daily Variety, declaring that I was not then and never had been a member of the Communist Party. And I said, "No, I'm sorry, I can't do that. If there are people feeling sincerely that I've done something wrong, let them accuse me of it publicly. Let me know who they are, and that I'll answer it." He said, "Miss Hunt, these are terrible times. Everything is out of proportion. It's unfair. I quite agree. But this is a time for expediency, not integrity."
"The judge has left town, Harvey's quit, and I'm having trouble getting deputies."
"It figures. It's all happened too sudden. People got to talk themselves into law and order before they do anything about it. Maybe because down deep they don't care."
Meanwhile, my partners began to hint that if I persisted, I might well have to take a long leave of absence from the company. Perhaps leave it entirely.
"Will, I think you better go while there's still time. It's better for you and it's better for us."
I told them that I accepted this possibility, that I had no desire to embarrass or hurt them. Oversimplifying, I told them truthfully that I knew no one anywhere whom I could say was a communist. I couldn't buy my career by being just a little bit of an informer and just name those who had already been named. That if we fought, we would be making a good fight, that we had a chance, that... but why go on? It all sounds and reads somewhat fantastic now. Anyway, when they heard the phrase Fifth Amendment, they blanched. I didn't like it either, but there didn't seem to be any other way to avoid going to jail. I didn't mind that. I considered it most seriously, but my wife and later my lawyer took a dim view of that approach and finally dissuaded me. I still rather regret it. Naturally, the staff at Columbia got wind of something, and it increased their disdain for the Western. The growing storm clouds began to be reflected in Stanley's attitude during the few times we met on High Noon. We seemed to buck each other on practically everything. I was in no mood to compromise anymore, and I fought for everything I thought necessary. And I fought all the way. Finally, he washed his hands of the whole picture, his attitude inferring that he was giving me enough rope. Naturally, all of this affected the content of the picture. Or maybe the content of the picture affected me. I really don't know now. It was easy for me to draw parallels at the time, of course.
"Think I'm letting you down, don't you?"
"No.
Look, this is just a dirty little village in the middle of nowhere. Nothing that happens here is really important. Now get out."
"There isn't time."
"What a waste. Good luck."
Anyway, by the time we reached rehearsals, it was obvious that I was going to have to go before the committee, and the future thereafter was uncertain. I thought the time had certainly come when certain people had to know, so that they could protect themselves in any way they saw fit. These were Fred, very insecure these days because of his foreign birth and name, Cooper, considering his political background and point of view, and Bruce Church, our angel, and not only a Republican, but a businessman with money invested. All of them had the right to back out of the picture if they felt that my association with it or them could hurt them. I met them individually and told them about the subpoena and what I intended to do. I held nothing back. Well, you know, they didn't get out. And each in his own way were really quite wonderful. They were, if you will forgive me, real Americans.
This particular evening, after we finished bowling, we usually broke up and went home. Carl said, "I'd like to go back with you to Dominic's and let's have some coffee. There's something I want to talk to you about." So we all went back to Dom's, sat down at one of his beat-up tables, and Carl said, "I've been called before the Un-American Activities Committee." And that was a real shocker. We were rocked. Herbie Baker and I were just stunned by the news.
Anyway, we started shooting the picture. From the very first day, nobody at our Columbia front office was happy about it. The photography was questioned. There were remarks about slowness, dullness, too much underplaying. Somehow, although everyone had read the script, nobody seemed to remember that the small pieces of mosaic they saw in the dailies were part of a carefully designed pattern, that suspense is often increased by retarding pace, that strong emotions need not be shrieked through a megaphone to be understood and felt.
"Do not forsake me, oh my darling. On this our wedding day, do not forsake me, oh my darling. Wait, long. The noonday train will bring Frank Miller. If I'm a man, I must be brave. And I must face that deadly killer. Or I a coward, a craven coward. Or lie a coward in my grave. Oh, to be torn twixt love and duty, supposing I lose my fair beauty. Look at that big hand move along, near in high noon. He made a vow while in state's prison, thought it would be my life or his. And I'm not afraid of death, but oh, what will I do? You leave me, do not forsake me, oh my darling. You made that promise when we wed. Do not forsake me, oh my darling. Although you're grieving, I can't be leaving until I shoot Frank Miller dead. Wait long, wait long, wait long, wait long.
As was my custom, I was on the set from the first shot to the last, but I got the general reaction when any of the palace guard dropped by. Naturally, it depressed me a little, but I felt sure Fred and I knew what we were doing. Then, as we rounded into the second week, the roof fell in. I was summoned to a meeting at Columbia.
The day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all...
I came over from the high noon set, and my lawyer, Sidney Cohn, came along. They had their lawyer there, or two from the Zagon, Aaron, and Sandler operation. Something had happened since the last time. The telephone call was Stanley, because my partners were already there. Their faces were cold and set. They had already had their meeting. Stanley's voice was harsh and remote. Sidney said he was going to represent me. He was quite confident that everything would be done to protect my interests. Well, that upset Stanley. He said something about not having a New York shyster to dictate what was going to happen, and that he had formed the company, perhaps even molded this company with his own hands, and he was prepared to wreck it on the basis of principle. It was that Stanley that he had now become, the Hitlerian carpet eater. By now, Stanley was calling me foreman. The meeting ended more or less inconclusively. There would be meetings between the lawyers, and we would see what would happen. I have to tell you, by this time, the feeling had become so strong that the picture itself was the least popular aspect of the whole Kramer operation. Now he never came around at all. And while they did see the rushes, they saw them separately from us. By us, I mean Freddie and myself. Stanley would see it with his editor, Harry Gerstad, and George. Freddie and I would see it with our editor, Elmo Williams. We were told Stanley just hated the rushes. Nothing but rude remarks all the time. They didn't like what they saw, and we just, I don't know, Fred was a dope who couldn't direct, and everything was going wrong. It was just no good. Which didn't make us any happier as we went about our business. A few days later, they decided they'd better take action. I was on the set at the ranch again. George Glass came out with an envelope for me. It contained a copy of a letter from Stanley to me. In fact, Stanley wrote me two letters, which also came to the house in Brentwood, registered. In one letter, as president of the Stanley Kramer Company at Columbia, he told me I was discharged from all my positions at the company, as a member of the board of directors, as a company officer, that I was not to come around anymore, and not to come around Columbia. In the other letter, he wrote to me as head of Stanley Kramer Productions, which was producing High Noon, and told me that I was no longer to serve as a producer on High Noon, and not to come around that picture anymore either. I refused A, to turn my stock over to the tender mercies of Mr. Katz, B, to appear before the committee as a man already tried, judged, and found guilty by his own friends and associates, and C, to leave High Noon. I said that it was widely known in Hollywood that I had written and was producing the picture. So, if it was being contaminated by me, the disease was far too advanced. I was told that if I didn't stay away voluntarily, I would be barred physically. I called Sidney Kahn in New York, and he said, "Look, they can't do this to you. You can't be discharged. It's just not possible. You can't be discharged as the producer of this picture. You can't be discharged as a company officer. They can't have meetings without you being present. They just can't do it." So he said, "Tomorrow, this is what I want you to do. I want you to go into Columbia tomorrow as treasurer of the company, of the Stanley Kramer Company. I want you to go to your office, and I want you to call for the books. And when they say to you, 'What for?' you say, 'Because you're the treasurer of the company, and you want to audit the books of the company.'" I said, "Sidney, for Christ's sakes, if I go to Columbia, there's a cop there. They'll send this letter, and he'll have my name down there. And I'll go to Columbia, and he'll say, 'Oh, yeah, you can't come in here,' and I'll never get into my office." He said, "Insist on it. If they won't let you in, tell them you're going to call the police, because you're the treasurer of that company, and nobody has the right to keep you out of its offices." He said, "I'll be out there as soon as I can." Well, I told Fred I'd be busy the next day, and I went to Columbia. My heart pumping, I approached the fellow, the uniform guy that sat sitting in his little cubicle at the entrance of the lot, and he said, "Hello, Carl." I thought, oh my God. He hasn't got the note yet, obviously, from upstairs. And I went in, took the elevator up to our floor, and just as I got out, the door opened. And there I was in the elevator, and there waiting to get in the elevator was the entire law firm of Zagan, Aaron, and Sandler. Half a dozen Columbia lawyers, it looked like. Well, Kramer was there, and Sam Katz was there, and they obviously were having a meeting about little me. We stared at each other for a moment. They were staggered to see me, just as I was to see them. Then I got out and turned the corner and went to my office. Mary Malone was there, my secretary. She was staggered to see me. And I said, "I'm going to my office, and I want you to bring me the company books." "Oh," she said, "certainly." And I went into my office, and after a while, there was a knock on the door, and there was Sandler. He said, "I've got a paper here that I'd like you to sign. It's perfectly in order. It has nothing to do with any of this, and it's just something that should have been signed some time ago. It's a little oversight, and if you could just sign it right now." So I looked at it. I knew it was an important thing. And I said, "Well, I'm not signing anything now. I have a lawyer now. Just leave it with me." And he said, "Well, it's only a deferment agreement, you know, on High Noon. It's really nothing to do with..." Well, the point is, I caught a lucky break. It developed that I hadn't yet signed my deferment papers for the Bank of America, and without my signature, the loan could not go through. I was in the driver's seat.
Carl caught a lucky break by not having signed his deferment papers, because obviously he was going to be paid a substantial amount of money, both as a writer and as a producer, and the money was due him. And by not signing the papers, it meant the money was still due him. Had he signed those deferment papers, it would have meant that his salary for those two jobs would have been deferred until the film went into profits. By not signing it, it meant that the company owed him an enormous amount of money. So he really had a certain amount of control because he hadn't signed those papers.
I got a new letter from the company, signed by Stanley, George, and Katz. I was to return to my duties with special emphasis on High Noon. The question of whether my name on it as producer would harm the picture at the box office would be decided by Cooper and Church at the time of release. And no public statements of any kind would be issued by any of us until 60 days after my appearance before the committee. 60 days. I'd still never left the set. Of course, while this had been going on, Stanley had been shocked when Fred and Cooper and Church, on their own, each pleaded and, in fact, insisted that I remain with the picture. None of them was concerned with the political aspects of the situation, but only with the welfare of the picture. Naturally, he was annoyed, too, for he was offering to take over himself. At any rate, he'd kind of gone too far to back down, but he really didn't have much choice since no one else was going to work with him. Stanley asked me to see him. He was still stunned, almost shattered, puzzled by the attitudes of Fred Cooper and Church, bewildered by my rather new intransigence. We had a long and really intimate talk, and although it was obvious that we could never be the kind of friends we had been, and that most likely my days with the company were numbered, we reached what I thought was sympathy and understanding. I'd never wanted to fight him. I'd loved him. And even now, I hated to see him feel humiliated by defeat. He confessed his own personal fears and the dangers to his own career he felt inherent in my committee appearance. I assured him that if his name came up, I would insist on informing the committee that he had always been a liberal, and indeed an anti-communist, which of course was true. We were together for 2 hours. He told me that if it became necessary for me to leave the company, that we should try to avoid bringing in the lawyers, that he would protect my interests. And he reiterated the promise that there would be no statements made for 60 days. 60 days. He begged me to rescind the power of decision I had given Cooper and Church as to my producer credit and give it to him as the head of the company. He explained that without it, he was in an untenable and humiliating position. I agreed. When we parted, it seemed as if we were as close as we had ever been in the last year. We shook hands, put our arms around each other. I went back to the set. We have never spoken to each other since. I was tired that night and I overslept. Before leaving for the studio, I switched on the television to catch a bit of the hearings, and I heard myself named. Ironically enough, the man who named me was a perjurer. My name had been given to him by the committee investigators, with about 10 others, on a might-as-well basis. At the studio, I informed Fred and told him I thought the cast and crew should know about it from me, and at ease, rather than read about it in the morning papers, with a consequent disorganization of the next day's work. He agreed. At the completion of the next scene, we called the company together. I told them I couldn't foretell the future or what would happen, but I didn't want this to affect the film in any way because I was afraid that it might. The film meant a great deal. We'd all worked very hard. I asked everyone. I said Fred and I had worked closely together. I might have to be away from the film for some time, so I wanted them to all give Fred their complete support. When I talked, I could obviously see the faces of the people, and since the papers had not yet come out, many of them were shocked. The vast majority were very moved and very supportive. I concluded by saying what was true and that I was now going to see my lawyer and get ready for the hearings and my appearance, which was in a few days from then. Then I went to the parking lot and to the car. I was almost at the car when I heard Coop yelling after me. He'd followed me from the set and he'd been very moved by it. He said, "Uncle, that's the best speech I ever heard," he said. "Listen, it's like you do what you feel you have to do, but don't let them put you in jail." Those are Coop's exact words. "Don't let them put you in jail." He didn't want me to go to jail, and he wasn't sure about the legal position. He thought that if you didn't cooperate, then you would go to jail. I had been right about telling the cast and crew. The work went on without a hitch. As a matter of fact, the company was wonderful all the way through. If anything, they all worked harder thereafter. Nobody talked about it except to come to me when I was alone and to wish me well. After a day or so, when the grips and prop and wardrobe guys began to rib me about going to jail and being a spy, I knew I was still at home, and that the sickness hadn't infected everybody in the country. 2 days later, it was time for me to go downtown. I waited for my turn, listening and watching the ridiculous, cynically staged managed parade, the cooperative witnesses beating their breasts or posturing with newfound patriotism, parroting their carefully rehearsed answers to the rehearsed questions, some of them blushing when the ceremony reached the point of naming of names. The uncooperative witnesses going up, getting their heads bashed in and walking off like somnambulists.
He knew there are certain things he couldn't do, and one thing he could not do ever was name names. And that was the one thing they said he would have to do. And he said he couldn't do it. And they offered him, of course, all the deals that they were offering. He'd come in, practically empty room, name somebody who'd been named three or four times, and walk out, and that's it, home free. And he said no, and he couldn't do that. And the House Un-American Affairs Committee man said, "But you wouldn't hurt you wouldn't hurt anybody." Carl said, "I would destroy myself."
Finally, it was my turn. I faced the television cameras and did my best. "Well, sir, I am an American, and I was born here, and I love this country. I love it as much as any man on this committee. It is very difficult to prove it. There is only one way to prove it, and that is to go out and get killed, because talk is very cheap. You can wrap yourself in the American flag, but I love this country. I have always supported it, its constitution, and the American way of life. My feeling is that we are here engaged in a war of ideas, and that ideas should and must find their way into the common marketplace. and will be accepted or rejected by the people. I have faith in the American public. And I have a feeling that the imposition of oaths somehow smacks of police state methods, and I kind of don't like that. I want you to know about me, that I try to be a good American in my daily life and in my work. I think that Americanism is reflected in my work. You misjudge me or infer by what I do, sir. I can only tell you one more time that if I knew of anyone committing or even thinking of committing treason against this country, I would get down to the FBI just as quickly as I could. It was over in an hour. It didn't hurt too much. I called home, but the line was busy. It remained busy for more than an hour. When I reached my wife, she said that she was proud of me. She watched it on television. I felt good about it. She said that people were calling constantly and saying nice things. I went home and packed because the company was moving to Sonora County for location. Telegrams began coming in and continued to come for several days afterwards, and letters too. All nice.
Something that touched me very much. We had bought some appliances from some appliance store, and they sent a large assortment of flowers which said, "To the home of the brave."
Nothing, however, from Stanley, or George, or Katz. I joined the company in time for the first shot. The work went well. That night, my wife called. There were big stories in the press that Stanley was disassociating himself from me. AP and UP had called her. What should she say? I told her to say nothing. So much for 60 days. The next day, I flew into Los Angeles and went to Columbia. Stanley just left for New York. I left word for him to call me, either from New York or when he returned. He never did. So much for 60 days.
But Stanley Kramer was an amazing producer. And he was an independent at a time when there really were no independents. And he had his own sensibility for films. And he was certainly early on a great partner and a colleague of Carl Foreman's, who really was the spirit of that company. And when he was faced with the question of whether to potentially, I guess, betray a friend or keep the company, that's a tough decision to make. I mean, all of us hope that we would make the right decision, but I, for one, don't know what I would have decided.
So I went back on location. Finally, the film was done. We had the usual party for the cast and crew. We took over part of what was on the stage where we'd shot the last scene between Caddy Jurado and Lloyd Bridges.
Hey, you don't suppose Kane's scared of those three gunnies?
Stanley Kramer did not attend. George didn't come. Nobody attended from Columbia Pictures. Nobody attended from the Kramer Company. Yeah, but it was a good party anyway. Next day, the settlement discussions would begin in an unpleasant atmosphere. The night I signed the papers, I stopped at the Vine Street Derby for a drink and ran into the committee investigator who had handed me my subpoena. A real Hollywood coincidence. We kidded around for a while. I said something about his perjured witness. The fellow who had named me, he laughed and said, "Oh, it doesn't matter. We've got some legitimate ones on you now." Now I was through with the company I'd helped form and build. By terms of my settlement, I was now finished with High Noon, too, but I kept in close touch through Fred, Dimitri Tomkin, and Elmo Williams, my editor. Fred's version followed the script throughout, but Stanley didn't like it and took over. He cut it brutally, almost, it seemed, with venom. Everyone agreed the version was bad. He gave in finally, and Elmo Williams took over and returned the cut to Fred's original version.
He said, "I'm going to go to Palm Springs for the weekend," and he said, "I'll decide what to do with this film while I'm down there." While he was gone, I worked day and night, and I re-edited the entire film.
And it was that version that Stanley Kramer would ultimately claim as his own. As I've said, Fred was great throughout, on both personal and creative levels. Dimitri Tiomkin made superb contributions. Floyd Crosby was a delight to work with. Elmo Williams is, I think, the best, most creative editor in Hollywood. I began to get offers from various people. Mr. Robert Lippert, the independent producer, came to me and said he had a scheme for financing very low-budget films, and he said he wasn't afraid. And that was very encouraging, In fact, we announced that relationship, but now the question was whether I would, in fact, be able to survive and work again, and that perhaps High Noon would not be my last film. Maybe I could break the blacklist if I could form my own company. When Gary Cooper found out about this, well, what happened staggered me. He went to Prinsmetal, his lawyer, who then came to me and said, "Coop wants to invest. He wants to be a shareholder in your company." Absolutely staggered I was, you know. And Prinsmetal said, no, he's very serious about it. His wife wants to take a piece of your action. His father-in-law, who's a very shrewd and knowledgeable Wall Street man, he was a very big investment broker, they all think you're very talented, and they think you're going to lick it. So they want to be part of the operation. Well, I wanted Henry Rogers of Rogers & Cowan, the publicity firm, top of the mark, to represent us with this new company. And Henry said, rather than take a fee, he'd like a piece of the action. So everybody got 5% or whatever it was. And I told Prinsmetal it would never work. I said Cooper just couldn't understand what would happen. I said it was a marvelous gesture and everything. But Prinsmetal said, no, it's not a gesture. He really feels that you are going to be a very profitable operation. I said, it's going to cause a tremendous furor. In time, if you say you want, if Coop wants out, you have out. There'll be no problems, I promise you this. So we published the formation of the company and who the stockholders were. Well, Variety gave it a marvelous headline right across the front. It was very, very prominently reported. And of course, the whole thing had a marvelous kind of Alice in Wonderland connotation. Here was Gary Cooper, who'd been a staunch pillar of the right for so many years, testified in the very first hearings. There he was, in my company. Oh boy, it set the town by its ears. It was most amusing, made some people angry. And within 3 or 4 days, the pressure did start. Very quickly, editorials, letters, and all that, everyone trying to get a hold of Cooper for his statement, but he was away. So it was Prinsmetal who took the brunt of most of it, and ultimately became a very serious situation because Jack Warner called, or so Prinsmetal told me. Called him in and invoked the morals clause. Cooper had a contract then for X number of pictures at a salary of $200,000 a picture, which was very, very high. It was the only place in town where he had a contract. High Noon was not yet out, and Cooper's films had not been doing all that well.
The powerful people in the media, people like Hedda Hopper, for example, was considered herself a great American, which I'm sure she was, but she was very anti anything liberal. And she attacked, after the announcement was made, she attacked Carl Foreman, she attacked Henry Rogers for being part of the new Carl Foreman company, and most of all, she attacked Gary Cooper, who had been a great friend of hers. And she exerted a lot of pressure, as did other journalists. John Wayne, who was very conservative, was very upset about the Gary Cooper association with Carl. He too exerted some pressures. And I would think that John Wayne considered himself, as do most people, a great American, but he felt it was the tenor of the times. Everyone was very nervous about anything where people could slip liberal messages into screenplays. That's what it was all about.
I said to Prinsmetal, don't worry about it. You go ahead. See if you can get hold of Cooper so he knows. Get his statement released and try to make a nice one if you can, but you're out. And they did that. And Cooper's statement was very warm and dignified. He made it quite clear that he was getting out because of pressure and regretting it, saying he had a great regard for me as a person and a filmmaker. You couldn't ask for anything better than that. But it did have one other result, and that was the famous meeting with John Wayne. Now, that came about because of Henry Rogers, who was also a shareholder in the operation. Henry got called into the office of the Beau Roos Management, which at that time had this large business management company on the corner of Brighton and Camden. Henry was called in, and he was told that he was in trouble. John Wayne and Ward Bond were going to go to all of Henry's most important clients and take them away from him on the grounds that Henry was mixed up in this, was a subversive or tainted by being in a company with a subversive, namely me. So Henry came to me in a great state and his wife Rosalind and was terribly upset, as was Warren Cowan, because it meant they were going to wreck his business. I said, Henry, that would be a terrible thing to do and a terrible position for you to be in. You must go back to Roost and see if you can't arrange a meeting for me with Wayne so I can explain to him that I have no political connection at all with you. And that was how John Wayne and I came together on a Saturday in November. We met in his offices. I told the story about Henry. Oh, he dismissed that. It became obvious that that was not really the object of the exercise. All Henry had to do was leave the company, and they'd leave him alone. No. What the meeting really was for was to see if Wayne couldn't persuade me to recant and go back to the committee and become a loyal American. "You're the kind of man we need," he said. "You can't turn your back on us. Who are you? Who do you think you are?" He was furious. He was on his feet at that point. He went around hitting the wall with his fist, the largest fist I'd ever seen. And then he linked me with Bob Rawson, who'd also been an unfriendly witness, and talked about High Noon and ranted on and on. He was very angry with Cooper because Cooper betrayed his movement and all that. He may well have said that I'd hurt Gary Cooper, to which my reply was that I would not want to hurt Gary Cooper in any way. He said to me at this point, when he was threatening me and telling me how bad it was going to be if I wasn't sensible, that I'd never work again. I said, "Well, I'll go to Europe and work." And so, I have to give him credit for making me realize that Bob Rawson was right. He had warned me that there was a real possibility that they would deny unfriendly witnesses like he and I our passports. We'd be unable to leave this country and would have to stay in a place where we could not find work. Well, Wayne went on, and he was pretty angry and left me no out. It was all or nothing, and promised me that I would never work again. The point is, John Wayne seemed to know what he was talking about. It's possible I might not be able to break the blacklist, and I thought it would be a very good idea, therefore, if I went to New York. The picture was completely finished, and Fred Zinnemann was making his cut. I thought two things. First, I would go and apply for a passport in New York, not Hollywood. Bob Rawson also had said that time was running out on him, and he'd better get his passport, but he was going up to San Francisco. Had this Chinese fellow in a San Francisco office to get his. I thought that while I was in New York, I'd go and see plays. Maybe the thing to do was to pick up stakes and go to New York and try and write for the theater. Anyway, I reached New York and I applied for the passport. Estelle and I stayed there long enough to get it. And after seeing a lot of theater, I have to say, I thought, I can do this. It's not really all that great. I think I might be able to work it out. But on the way back, we took the train, and I had a change of heart. I had the feeling we'd just be running away, and I said to Estelle, I'm going to stick it out for another 6 months until we see whether or not it can be broken. She said, fine. I went back to the Motion Picture Center and took an office there. Jose Ferrer was starring in The Shrike on Broadway, and he wanted to do the film with me. Well, Joe's agent out here was Kurt Fring, so I had to go and see him. Well, Joe Ferrer was a very important client for him, and Frings was very frank with me. He said, "I don't care what Joe Ferrer says. I will never allow him to work with you. He'd only get in trouble. His career would be hurt. He's a very important client to me, and I would rather see you dead first than have him work with you." It was pretty much the same everywhere I went when it came to actors' agents or publicity people.
Carl Foreman saw in it an allegory on his own personal experience in the McCarthy era. It was misinterpreted as a subversive gesture, that on the grounds that the tin star was a symbol of federal authority and the man throwing in the dust was committing an act of blasphemy or subversion.
And then a Mr. Roy Brewer, who'd been a great force in the movement, sort of a goal lighter, you might say, redoubled the pressure on me. He let it be known throughout the union that if anybody, any member, worked with me, it would prove they were subversive by their association with me, and they would be blacklisted themselves.
The IATSE, which is the International Alliance of Stage and Technical Employees, is a very powerful union, and they operate everything. They operate the cameras, the lights, the sound equipment, everything you need to make a motion picture. And if you cross the IA, it's very difficult to make a film. So if the IA were to say that they weren't going to support a particular film or they were going to withhold their members' services from that particular film, certainly at that period of time, it would have been impossible to make a movie.
And that was when I had my passport and the possibility of England loomed so large. Estelle and I discussed it, and it was determined that I should leave and try and rebuild a life there, and she'd join me as soon as things were settled. I took the train by myself to New York. About the same time, Bob Rawson arrived there, and he was very unhappy. He had not gotten his passport renewed in San Francisco by his Chinese friend, so he was stuck. And of course, he was terribly, understandably, very envious that I had the freedom to go. I felt very guilty about it. And I guess I felt lucky as well.
The night before he sailed to England, he invited Herbie and Camille and Harriet and me to dinner, just us. And Herbie always, at every dinner, after dinner, would always sit down at the piano and improvise and make up these songs and sing them. And this night, he sat down there, and for an hour, he had me doubled over in a knot. He was doing a song called Matzahs in Mayfair. And what the song was, Carl's influence on England.
Naturally, I saw a lot of Sidney Cohn as well. That last day when I went down to the ship, both Sidney and Bob Rawson came to see me off, and I did feel very, very badly about Bob. Here I was on board this ship, but looking at Bob, well, Bob was in prison. It was a big prison, but nevertheless, he was in prison. He couldn't get out of it. He didn't have his passport. As darkness came and the night tide, I left for England. In the meantime, this history of High Noon continued without my intervention. It was now entirely in the hands of Stanley Kramer.
We took the picture to Pomona, and we previewed it down there. We had a second preview at Long Beach. And I went with Stanley and his wife, Ann, in the limousine down there. We had very mediocre previews, both of them. So Stanley, in his own mind, was pretty sure this film was a turkey, you know. And he still was undecided about what to do with it. Cohen had made this big deal with Kramer, and he didn't want to fail, you know. He didn't want his judgment to be faulty. So he kept hearing about High Noon, and this was the last Kramer independent. And he thought he better look at it just in case. And if it was good, he'd take it over and distribute it through Columbia. And he screened it. And he didn't think much of it. George Schaefer had been head of distribution for RKO, and I ran into him one day and I said, George, he asked me what I was doing, and he was retired now, mind you. And I told him I'd finished this Western, and I said, it's funny. The only people that seem to have any faith in it is myself and Lynn Unkifer. Lynn was the publicity man. And I said, I think there's a damn good film there. And he said, well, who's distributing it? I said, I don't know. I don't think they've set that. And he made a deal for himself. And he made himself rich out of it. He distributed the film. He took over the selling of it.
By the time all this was done and the film was getting ready to open, I was trying to reconstruct my life in England as best I could.
Somewhere around July, Kate and I joined him in London. Carl was kind of a different man when I got there. He was not the husband who had left. He was angry now all the time. He'd try to sit at a typewriter and write, and he was too angry, he couldn't write.
When he sat down at the typewriter, all he could write was Dear Editor. He literally couldn't write. You have no office to go to. You have no regular income coming in. You're in a strange country, however much you feel at home, and you speak the language, which is very important. You have no place to belong. So they were cut off from work, from home, from family. That's partly why he also couldn't write. It wasn't just that he wasn't employed. Everything changed overnight.
Kate couldn't understand why we were there. She was 5 years old, and she kept saying, Mommy, I don't like it here. Let's go home. Why are we here? And I said, well, Daddy has to work here.
It was very hard because his daughter was four and a half at the time, four and a half to five, and had not known anything except the lovely, warm California. And his then wife had to adopt to a totally different way of life, which he said was very difficult for both of them, and probably did more damage, that change did more damage to their relationship than anything, and it must have been very difficult.
There wasn't any central heating in this so-called flat. And I came down with a god-awful something or other.
Eggs were still rationed, which was a great shock because there was such plenty. He said the toilet paper was very hard, and he remembered feeling very embarrassed when he wrote off for the things pleased to send, you know, eggs and toilet paper and ketchup, and he had not realized the tremendous deprivation. He said we knew about the bombs and, you know, what had gone on, but in 1952, people were still deprived. There were still huge holes all over London. Really brought it home to him.
But it was terrible. We went through the terrible smog they had there. There was one night we were having a dinner party, and Carl couldn't get home from the office because the smog was so thick, you couldn't see a foot in front of your face. He finally got home around 6 or 7 o'clock, and he said he was directing the buses because they couldn't see. I remember when I got undressed that night, I was wearing a white slip and I threw it on a chair. And when I woke up the next morning, there were black streaks on it from all the oily smog that came in through the window.
My wife and I went to England in 1953. Then you could see immediately that the marriage was a wreck, and the daughter had been a victim of the wreck.
Later on, when his passport was lifted, he felt they were trying to take his country away.
Finally, he decided that Kate and I should move back to Los Angeles and he would join us in a few months. Anyhow, we went. And, you know, that was really the end of the marriage.
We used to go out, my wife and I used to go out with Carl and his new wife after they got married. Somehow, from that time, his mood changed back again, and he became creative and was more like his old self, you know.
Selling novel, Live to the Hilt on the Islands of the Aegean Sea.
I enjoy working on a Foreman picture because I think the preparation is so extensive. You never have the feeling on a Foreman picture that anything is left to chance.
Obviously, Carl Foreman had a great creative talent. It's always sometimes a miracle to me that people know how to write for the movies, because it just seems to me that writing for the movies is difficult. It's more difficult than writing a novel in a sense, because you've got to know what need not be said, and but also know how to tell stories visually.
Based on Yonder Hartog's greatest novel, brilliantly written for the screen by Carl Foreman and superbly directed by Carol Reed, here's what some of the world's keenest and most objective minds have said about The Mouse That Roared. Now Columbia Pictures presents Carl Foreman's The Victor. Vincent Edwards, Albert Finney, George Hamilton, Melina Mercouri, Jeanne Moreau, George Papard, Rosanna Schiaffino, Romy Schneider, Elkie Sommer, Eli Wallach, co-starring Peter Fonda, Jim Mitchum, The Victors.
We were all very much in awe of him. We went into a meeting in his office, and he had one of those round chairs on wheels, and he kept leaning back on this. And at a certain point, he fell over completely backwards. And we were all so in awe of him that none of us wanted to sort of get up and help him up, because we thought it would draw attention to the fact that he'd fallen over.
It was just so inappropriate because he was Carl Foreman, and Carl was like godfather of the project. And he had a photograph of Winston Churchill on the wall, which was not just cut out of a book or a magazine. It said to Carl, Winnie, something like that. And it was just so inappropriate that he should do something so undignified.
He said, your script's a very good script. He said, what it needs is a chariot race. He said, by which I mean a moment when people walk out of the cinema, they'll say, what about that bit when? And he said, go away and write a chariot race. And we puzzled our heads and looked at each other and thought, okay. And we ended up writing the driving test sequence in Otley, which is a car chase taking part in the middle of somebody doing their driver's test.
All right, Mr. Otley, you've passed. Look, I'm filling in the passport now.
Kiss me quick and nibble my ear. Tickle my fancy, call me dear. Give me a bed and a pint of beer. Homeless bone.
Born Free. Joy Adamson's fascinating adventures in Africa with Elsa the Lion.
Ago, Sir Winston Churchill asked Carl Foreman to produce a motion picture based on his book.
Carl Foreman and Richard Attenborough have joined forces to bring to the screen the story of young Winston.
So Carl Foreman was once again productive. He was a man who would never be a victim. On the contrary, he was a man who reached out to others, a passer of the torch.
KCET presents After Film School What?
When he came back to this country last year to begin production on a film for Columbia Pictures called McKenna's Gold, he had the notion of finding some young filmmakers and giving them an opportunity to make their own films in and around the making of McKenna's Gold on location in Arizona and Utah. The filmmakers, Chuck Braverman, 23, George Lucas, 23 also, both from USC at the time.
Columbia Pictures proudly presents Gregory Peck at his greatest, and Omar Sharif.
First of all, it was 110 degrees out in the desert every day, and it was very tough filming. And yet I thought that Carl was sort of the calm in the center of the storm. I think there were all kinds of problems swirling around the production because of the logistics involved, because of all the stars involved. And this was easy for him compared to what he'd been through in the past.
Gregory Peck, co-starring in the Columbia Pictures film with Omar Sharif, is reunited with Carl Foreman and director J. Lee Thompson.
Thing I realized that we were very similar, we were very much alike in terms of that we had certain ideals about things and certain moral feelings and things that we just weren't going to give in on.
Finally, the anguish behind him and his passport restored, Carl continued to work in both the United States and England, splitting time between his homes in London and Los Angeles. He was elected once again to the board of the Writers Guild of America, adding to his post as President of the Writers Guild of Great Britain and President of the International Writers Guild. And the spirit of reconciliation would extend even to the oldest of his enemies.
Many years later, Carl was in California with the children, with me, and we were in a little restaurant called Dantana's, and we walk in, and sitting at one of the booths was John Wayne. And he looked, they looked at each other. John Wayne stood up, huge. Carl went over, he embraced him, and they chatted. And Carl said, I want you to meet my English son, and I want you to meet my English daughter. And they talked as if nothing had ever happened.
I was not aware what was the circumstances, but I knew that he hurt you, and I heard from other people that he hurt you very much. And Carl said, you know, He was a patriot, and I'm a patriot. We're both Americans. And he didn't do it to hurt me. He thought he was helping America.
Now, that couldn't have happened with Stanley Kramer, because once, not long before he was in the lift at Columbia, the elevator at Columbia, with Jonathan, our son, and Kramer got in the lift, elevator, and they looked at each other, and not a word was spoken. Nothing.
When all was said and done, what was it that buoyed Carl Foreman's spirit? How was it that he suffered so much, bore so much, and never collapsed, never broke under it, continued to do great work, and continued to leave a legacy of film that stands beside the greatest? So we have to go back to that letter to Bosley Crowther and how he finished it, and how he felt as he looked back on that awful experience when it was still so close to him.
And there you have it. I'm afraid this recital turned out to be more about me than the picture, but both me and it seem inextricably tangled up together. I'm anxious to get back to work, but I want to be excited about whatever I work on. At the same time, I feel like traveling a little too, and seeing what other film people are doing in different places and talking with them. On the whole, I think I'd like to work here. Certainly it's nice to be wanted. Between you and me, though, the only trouble is that all I know or really care about is America and the American scene.
And he was and always remained to his dying day an American, and being proud of an American. He never would do films that were anti-American, ever. I mean, goodness knows over the years he was asked to do that. He refused. He felt it was wrong.
Anyway, you now know why, in this instance, I'm so happy about the critical reaction to High Noon. And that audiences seem to like it, too. I understand from UA that it's broken house records, etc., and they're very pleased. But not as pleased as I am. Thank you. My best. Carl Foreman.
There was only one thing he ever wanted to do, and that was to write for films.
When he came out to California third or fourth time, he joined a... there was a writer's workshop, and Dory Sherry, who later became the head of MGM, was one of the teachers. And Carl had been selling blood for $25 a pint to pay the rent and the expenses and things. While he submitted something to this class, and at the end of it, Mr. Sherry said, "Would Mr. Foreman stand up, please?" And he said, "Mr. Foreman, you are a writer." And he said, That was so amazing. Subsequently, Sherry paid the fees because he couldn't afford them as well.
I do believe, you see, that the cinema holds a mirror up to life, as is lived at a given period. The filmmaker really is a part of his society, he's a part of his milieu, and he expresses, really, not only what he feels, but what a great many other people feel, whether he knows it or not. So I found myself making a kind of comment in reverse about what I think, the way I think life should be.
The work, that was what mattered to Carl Foreman. The work. That was what sustained him and has made a gift to us of so much fine cinematic art. Fine, fine work. Of course, great work deserves recognition. And as we've noted, Carl Foreman perhaps has not gotten all of his. But before he died of a brain tumor in 1984, recognition would come. He'd been denied credit on The Bridge on the River Kwai, a script which he first wrote in the United Kingdom while blacklisted. In 1984, the Writers Guild of America was rectifying the scourge of pen names, putting correct names and credits on the screen, and more appropriately, restoring awards to the proper hands.
When I got it for him, I quoted him. He said it was always better late than never. And so the end of his story was, in a way, they made it right, insofar as it's possible. They did. And when he was dying, he knew he was going to get the Oscar, because Weaver came and told him, and they wrote a letter that he knew.
We long, we long. Thank you.
This program was produced by Whidbey Island Films, which is solely responsible for its content.